And no decision must be taken on anything technological, not on the software, not on the database, no money is spent on that, and you don't need competences on that. You need just people who know how to communicate. And this is not trivial. I mean, as I said, we started working in 1997, and even before, we are a school of design, and we know what it means to build something where you have to begin with the design. You spend 1 month, 2 months just for the design, before you start talking about what content am I conveying. So in this way, you skip all that, all the technical issues, all the design issues, and you really begin with the core of the message. What am I talking about? What do I want to convey? So this is the big advantage. For us, it's a revolution. And you need people who knows what? Cultural heritage, communication, semiotics, a totally different thing. Okay, so we are trying to answer now, because we've built, as I said, 30 applications like this. We are trying to answer, do they work? The question, do they work? We all think they are so cute, but you know, in Italy we say that every, how do you call it? Bug, the little insect, bug? In Naples we say that every bug looks nice to his own mother. I don't know if you have in Spain anything like that. But. So, you know, this is our bug, we're so proud of it. How nice applications we make, and they're really nice. Huh? But now we have the doubt, do they really work? Do people like them? And so, we have just started this user study related to the application I've shown you. There are copies of the applications that I've shown you. By the way, please, please, please take them because they're heavy and they don't want to bring them back. If you need to make presents for your friends. And the curator of that exhibition is a wonderful person because he likes us. And he gave us all his mailing list of friends of the museum. And he said, do what you want. And so we tried to answer this research question. Does the application act as a stimulus for visiting the exhibition? Does the application help to better understand the exhibition before and after the visit? We know we have many more questions. We want to address them. Like, for example, after 1 month, what do you remember of the application? What do you remember of the exhibition after 2 months? So we are, I mean, going on with this, but we've begun. The user study is still going on because the exhibition is on. These two targets, we, as I said, add this mailing list, and we have 115 questionnaires answered so far, so it's not a trivial number. And we also went there on site to interview the visitors, and we have 45 questionnaires answered so far, so numbers are start being interesting. And these are the very preliminary results. The first one, well, they are art lovers because they answer to a question stating that they visit more than 6 exhibitions per year, so they can be defined as art lovers. And you see, a lot of them has used the application between 5 to 20 minutes or even more than 20 minutes, which is a success for us because it means they visited probably most part of the application. Because the application lasts about, let's say, 8 minutes, the short navigation, and the whole half an hour, 20 minutes, something like that, so it's a good success. 63.6 of those who had not yet visited the exhibition said that now their interest to go and visit the exhibition has risen, which is a very good result. And also, we are very satisfied about this because they say they have a better understanding of the exhibition. And since they are art lovers, I mean sophisticated users, this is really a good answer. The overall opinion, they are satisfied. So, results are comforting. Okay, my very last topic is the instant multimedia schools. If you still still have some limits of patience. We launched a competition in Italian schools from year 2006 because we said, okay, the engine is so easy to use, why don't we let schools use it? And we asked kids to produce application about their own local culture. In the first year, we addressed only high school students, and we made an experiment with an elementary class. We discovered that the elementary class worked much better than the high school students, and then in the second year we opened the competition to any school grades, and we got a much better answer from elementary class. Really much more creative, actually, to speak the truth. Why did we do that? Because interacting with cultural institutions, we discovered this, that this is what we would like, and this is what actually happens, at least in Italy, I don't know, in Spain. The desire is that classes go to cultural heritage institutions and children start developing interest for culture, etc. The children can touch the culture they read about in books, and that cultural institutions help the cultural enrichment of children. This is the desire. But in reality, it is not always so. Sometimes it is, but it is not always so, because very often children interpret their visit to the cultural institutions rather than a sort of a holiday. The school trip is a sort of a free time, and they enjoy themselves a lot, but not necessarily because they're visiting something cultural, these Italian kids. And moreover, teachers told us that it's not that easy to relate the activities in school with the activities in the cultural institution. So we had this situation to handle with. And so we decided for the competition, and we, as you can see, first year, just high school students, very high school, the older ones, by the way, in the second year, anybody. We asked them to pay a visit to a local cultural institution, to talk to a local expert, and to select a theme of interest. And then they collect the material, take pictures, etc., and in the end they create their multimedia narrative. So I will show you briefly my last example, which is Milano Romana, that was done for the Museo Archeologico in Milan by these kids in elementary school of Milan. Just a second, and I have to put this. It's in Italian, I'm sorry, but maybe Spanish, Italian.
La chiesa di San Lorenzo a Milano ha subito il passato parecchi cambi abitati. All'inizio era cimitero pagano e Igene era situata fuori dalla cinta muraria. Successivamente fu modificata sino a diventare una basilica palatina, infine un luogo di culto. Di fronte alla basilica si trovano 16 colonne che provengono dal cortile. Tra le colonne e la basilica si trova una piazza dove c'è la statua di Costantino. La basilica di San Lorenzo contiene anche il sacello di Sant'Aquilino e in essa, ancora oggi, si svolgono funzioni religiose.
Here they present themselves.